start with Zach and then go over to Matt Weaver.
Mustache this year, no mustache this year.
Say it one more time.
Mustache this year, no mustache.
Not right now. We'll see what the year takes us.
I recognize that there's a lot of you guys are holding back with the quarterback, but as coordinator with either of those guys, are there things that you can point to where by Saturday you can say, if he's doing this, if I'm seeing this beyond the obvious, completing passes, et cetera, if he's doing this, if he's showing me this, he's playing well, and I've gotten comfortable, because if that makes sense?
I mean, the short answer to your question is yes. You know, I mean, I think, you know, pre-snap operation, taking care of the football, you know, all the things that are kind of, you know, of the utmost importance in playing the position, you know, both of those guys, you know, have to be in a position to do that. You got to play well. You know, typically when your quarterback plays well, your team plays well. Quarterback doesn't, you don't. So we've got to put both of them in a position to be comfortable.
We'll go Mason or Matt. You ready? We'll go Matt, then Mason.
Hey, Coach, at receiver, obviously you got some guys on the outside that, you know, kind of somewhat proven to Cam, Camper, Don a little bit, E.J. Williams, but I'm curious about the slot position. Is there some guys that you feel like have stepped up there? How do you feel about that? And that being such an important part of, you know, opening up the middle of the field for you guys.
Yeah, you know, there's a couple ways to fill that role. You know, we've got some guys that not only are really good players outside, but also are smart enough and concepts sound to play inside. You know, so you'll see of the, you know, the Donnie Max, the Omar Coopers, the Cam Campers, the E.J. Williams, you may see them inside at times. DeQuise Carter, Cam Perry have both done a really nice job in camp. You know, and then, you know, the bonus, the move around towards Evan Lucas has also played there as well. So just depending on different personnel groupings and things that we're doing, you know, we've got, you know, multiple different ways to attack, you know, kind of that position.
We have Mason on your right and then Mike.
Coach, we heard last year that you guys were going to emphasize the run game a little bit more, your offense, and we've heard a lot this fall about how dynamic that running attack seems to be this year. But you guys have also run with a lot of pace, especially last year in your first year. How do you expect the run game to kind of dictate that pace, or do you think it will have any sort of impact on it at all?
The simplest answer is it really won't have any impact at all. You know, but our ability to run the ball, stay on the field, put us in more manageable third downs with young quarterbacks, and that's going to be huge. But from in terms of a pace of play standpoint, you know, we've got the ability to go as fast as we want to go. We've got the ability to go as slow as we want to go. You know, and so for me, it's just making sure that our right game is explosive. You know, and that we can win from the C-gap out. We can get the line of scrimmage when we need to. You know, and to me, it's just we've got to make sure that we're, you know, staying on schedule, you know, productive runs, efficient runs. Eliminating as many negatives as we can in the run game. So, but no, in terms of pace and how we play, and, you know, really won't have much to say on how we play.
We'll go Mike on your left and then Don.
I know it's kind of difficult about, you know, kind of getting a on the job, but what were your quarterback at the quarterback position deciding factors for you and how you kind of determined who you did kind of think and say, ooh, I decided I'll start?
Yeah, I think first and foremost, the young guys eliminating error. You know, how does that happen? That's, you know, your entire pre-snap process. You know, eliminating issues at the line of scrimmage. If a guy's not right, can you get him right? You're at the line of scrimmage communication. You know, your communication on the sideline, you know, when we do hook. But number one is just minimizing error. You know, number two is after the snap, can you drive your eyes where we're supposed to early in the downs? And can you be smart with the football late in the downs? And those two things are two completely different things, but they both manifest themselves in, you know, completions or, you know, balls in jeopardy. And then number three, I would think just comfortability, leadership ability. Do you create confidence in the other two guys on the football field when you're out there? You know, and so to me, those three things, especially younger guys, you know, are kind of the linchpins in having them make a decision.
We'll go Don back right.
Walt, can you talk a little bit about what you've seen out of the offensive line here in preseason, what your thoughts are about the improvement in that area?
Yeah, I think the first thing is just with Coach Bo said, and again, by no means is this an attack on Darren. You know, I love Darren. Darren's a great man, and a good person. You know, I want to get that out of the way first. But, you know, Coach Bo said, just the amount of repetitions, the time on task, how many reps of individual those guys accrue on a daily basis. So you're starting to see some technical proficiency. You're starting to see guys, from a marking standpoint, from a technique and fundamental standpoint, really start to take hold and kind of understand what we're trying to get done. You're starting to see a group of guys, because there's a lot of guys that have played, especially when you had Bedford back, and because Bedford went down and Carp went down for time, there are a bunch of young guys that had to play. So we've got 7 or 8 guys that played a lot of football, even with the addition of Max Longman, who played a lot of football at UMass. So we've got a pretty experienced group that's played a lot of football, but just to me, it's just, you're starting to see some technical proficiency, you're starting to see a little bit of an edge, which is earned, not a fake edge, they earn it in practice every day. There's probably no position group on our team, that devotes more time on task than the offensive line. So, I think early in the year, it's going to be really important for those guys to build some confidence and have success.
We'll go Pete on your left and then Zach.
Yeah, well, I know you obviously have seen Ohio State's new defense, but just overall, your thoughts on what problems they can present.
Number one is personnel. I mean, they got a really good group. I mean, if you really get down to it, if you take those 11 starters, name one of them who doesn't have a chance to play in the NFL. Rob Isbell. Every one of those guys is going to have a chance to play in the NFL someday. So, number one, they got great personnel. They're long. They can run. Number 35, Eichenberg, he may be the best back we'll see all year. He may be the best one in the country. He's a really good football player. They've got good players that play a lot of football all over their defense. I've got an unbelievable amount of respect for Coach Knowles. Coach Knowles, the guy that's had to do it the hard way. Play great defense everywhere he's been. Different styles. And I think that's the one thing that allows Coach Knowles to do such a nice job is he's always been very adaptive to his personnel. No matter where he's been. Because when I was in North Carolina, he was a Duke. So we saw those guys. And just the changes that you've seen from when he was at Duke to when he was over on State to Ohio State. So I think the challenge for us will be just kind of identifying, what's their flavor this year. But it's going to be a good game. We're excited to play him. He won't be off the bus. And so we'll be there.
We'll go Zach and Seth.
We want to have a question about slot receivers. Chris Carter's obviously a guy that came in late, but has a lot of experience. It seems like normally transfers kind of come mid-year these days, just moving the way the board works. How quickly was he able to kind of move himself into that rotation and kind of we saw more of him as fall camp went on? And maybe what's different about what he can bring when he's in the slot compared to maybe some of the guys he's working with in this
program? Number one is his experience. He's played a lot of football. He played a ton of reps at Fordham. The next thing for me is just he's got a little bit of long speed to him, and KB also can really, really, really run, but it's a guy that's a little more linear, a little bit of a thicker frame, and so we're going to need them both. Both of them are really good players, but, DeQuise has a little bit of a different skill set than KB, and then as you said, when DQ got here, a lot of thinking, a lot of learning when his camps went on, he's kind of, caught up to speed. He's been playing really well.
Go Seth on your left and Daniel.
You called Jalen Lucas the move around toy a little bit ago. Just when you look at the running backs you have, obviously, you've talked about trying to, maybe have multiple of those guys on the field together and, putting Jalen out in the slot. And just how do you kind of see, the rotation of those three when you look at Jalen, Josh, and Christian? Just how do you see that kind of playing out?
Some of it's game plan driven, some of it's health driven. Some of it depends on how well we're running the football. The thing that Jacob is, he's a guy who can truly play all over the football field. Josh has really good ball skills. Christian has played a lot of really valuable reps. Trent Howland was a big, thick, physical kid. So you got 3 or 4 guys there that you feel really comfortable with. Jacob can play all over the place. Josh has really good ball skills. Josh played in the slot, on the edge and some orange and stuff a year ago. So you feel really good about all 4 of those backs, and for us it's just game plan driven, formation driven. What can we do to create space touches for Jalen? How can we make sure that he's getting the right, not only he's getting the ball, but when he does possess the ball, it's in the right spot so he can be at his best. But we're excited about all 4 of those guys and excited for Saturday.
Daniel second on the right and then Jack.
for whoever you guys have named the starting quarterback that's going to start against Ohio State, you tried to tell them that, hey, you want a job, you don't need to be looking over your shoulder worrying that if you make a small mistake, the other guy can think, like, how important is it the guy plays, whoever is a quarterback in that first game, that he plays without being afraid of making small mistakes or maybe getting quick hook?
Yeah, you know, it's kind of two ways of looking at that. It's, the ultimate truth is that they got to get the best version of themselves. You know, no matter whether it's a close battle coming out of fall camp, no matter whether it was a big separated battle, you know, or everybody knows that this guy is the guy. No matter who goes out there, they got to be really focused on being the best version of themselves. You know, because when you do have a fear of making a mistake, when you do have fear of X, Y, or Z, that's when you're not going to be the best version of yourself. You know, they've got to work to a point. And they got to have enough confidence where they can surrender the outcome. Whatever happens, happens. As long as they know that they're prepared and they're going to put the best product, the best version of themselves on the field as soon as possible. And so, you know, to me, that's number one. You know, is you have to work to a point where the outcome is the outcome. It is what it is. But I'm in a position to be the best version of myself and have confidence in that. You know, and then number two, you know, especially the situation that we're in, you've got two really good young football players, guys that are both going to be really good football players. Is there's going to naturally be some of that, you know, and you just, that's got to be a daily fight every day. And not so much, you know, talking about, hey, you don't have to do that, you don't have to worry, you don't have to worry, you don't have to worry. Because the moment you start saying you have to worry, they really know inside of what they need to worry, you know. And so for me, it's just confident in what you do. You know, and you've got to work to a point, have enough belief in yourself and the work that you've put in, you know, that you've earned the right. Hey, don't worry about the outcome. I'm just going to go be the best version of myself.
Go to Jack on your right, and we'll finish up with Mike.
Yeah, with Jalen Lucas, I remember last year, especially early in the season, you talked about not trying to throw too many responsibilities on him. It seems like this year before the season, when we talked to him, he's very confident that he can do everything. Are there signs in practice that you see that he's able to kind of grasp having all those responsibilities that you feel like will show up?
Yeah, you know, and that's a huge credit to him because it's been August? It's been an 8-month process, you know, and he's spent a lot of time, you know, with wideouts in certain periods of practice going on back in spring. He spends, you know, more than 50% of his time with the running backs, you know, and also he's a returner, a kick returner. But he's a guy that's 100% willing to do the work, you know, and so for us, can he do? He could basically do everything that a running back or a wideout could do. Now it's our job just to make sure we're putting him in a position to do the things that he does best.
Mike,
your left question is actually an extension of that. How challenging is that? We have a player like that, mentioned kind of game planning, to get him in the right situations. Tom's talked about sort of a minimum touch count. You know, how much time goes into kind of figuring out all the pieces of that puzzle and getting him to that number?
No, it's a huge number, you know, because no matter what you do and no matter what you call, you see this challenge every week in the NFL. You know, it's a very matchup oriented league. It's no matter what you do, there are no guarantees. You know, I mean, there are some, you know, we can always put him in a position where, hey, if this ball does go to the perimeter, it's him. You know, if this ball does go here, it's him. But in terms of like true guaranteed, he's going to touch it no matter what, you know, there aren't a lot of those opportunities within the confines of really any offense. And so that's a huge challenge. You know, it's not only making sure that he gets the touches, but they're the right touches, so he can do the most amount of damage in the least amount of time. You know, and so that's a huge part, and will be for the next 12 weeks.
Great. Thanks, Walt.
All right, thank you guys.